talking about two words that are so uninspiring, almost nobody chooses to do research about them. Quantitative easing. Great, for the half of you still watching, this is going to be a huge episode, because the European Central Bank just released the results of a $2.6 trillion quantitative easing program. The term quantitative easing might sound familiar for some of you because America did it right after the financial collapse.
It's a third time the Federal Reserve has employed the program since 2008. Called quantitative easing, QE for short, the latest round will allow the central bank to purchase up to $40 billion in mortgage-backed securities each month, essentially increasing the U.S. money supply to promote lending and encourage businesses and consumers to spend.
Back to widescreen. Now I can stretch out. Yeah, after 2008, the U.S. bought up a ton of mortgage-backed securities, at a time when they were crashing about as badly as Bitcoin does every Thursday and Friday. Just a quick side note, that might sound like a terrible idea for government finances. Hey, all these assets are failing. Bye, bye, bye. But in actuality, once the market stabilized, the government made a killing. In 2015, we made almost $100 billion on interest alone from these assets, and have been posting similar numbers since. And you thought the big banks were the ones who came out on top after that collapse. So what is quantitative easing? Well, it's where the Fed uses computers to make new money and uses that to buy bonds on the open market. Well, that sounds about as world-changing to me as choosing to buy Pepsi instead of Coke. And this wouldn't have that big of an impact on the market, except we're talking about trillions of dollars. And when you dump that kind of money into a market, well, buckle up, because you just did the economic equivalent of hitting the nitro button in a racing game. So the next question, why? Well, we know the US economy was in the toilet, but today we're looking at the European Central Bank. Did investors there just think, well, it's a decent market right now, why not just invest $2.6 trillion? The reason depends on who you ask.
The ECB made the announcement only days before Greece holds elections on Sunday, a move that has been deemed political and has been widely criticized for getting the timing wrong.
The stated reason was that the European Central Bank hopes to shore up confidence, boost inflation, and drive down the value of the euro on foreign exchanges. And I'm inclined to believe that, because something's telling me that 2015 Greece wasn't exactly pulling all the strings in the European Central Bank. At that time, though, it was really cute, because you had the head of the European Central Bank saying, these purchases would continue until at least September 2016, or until we see a sustained adjustment in the path of inflation, which is consistent with our aim of achieving inflation rates below, but close to, 2%. Aww, you thought it was gonna end in 2016? Well, it's 2018, and your initial $1.1 trillion project is still going on and has more than doubled in price. So, alright, what a weird reason to do quantitative easing. We need inflation. That's kind of the exact opposite conversation we were having in America.
Will not allow inflation to rise above 2% or less.
Can you act quickly enough to prevent inflation from getting out of control?
We could raise interest rates in 15 minutes if we have to.
Well, if your goal is to increase inflation, I gotta tell you, there are more fun ways of doing it than quantitative easing. Might I recommend cargo planes airdropping trillions of ones on European towns? Just pick a sunny day and literally make it rain. Anyways, you do it your way, squares. Before we go on, why make the driving points of your expensive policy devaluing your currency? I mean, going out of your way to make your possessions less valuable? You must have gone to the Roseanne School of Money Management. Basically, that's the idea though. If you can make it so that when you produce the same product, it costs half as much as another country, well, then people are going to be buying more from you, and you'll be buying less from other people. That's why people are so mad about.
Trump told Reuters he thinks China is the grand champion of manipulation of currency in order to make its exports cheaper and steal American jobs.
Put another way, let's say that the dollar and the euro are valued at exactly the same. $1 can get you 1 euro. If wages are the same, you wouldn't care where you produce because you're a multinational and the most patriotic thing you can do is get as much money as possible. Now, let's say all of a sudden, it takes 2 US dollars to buy 1 euro. So that euro is half the price of a US dollar. Well, now, if the wages stay the same, American companies will want to produce in Europe, because the amount of money that can buy 1 hour of work in America can suddenly buy 2 hours of work when converted to the euro. Furthermore, they'll import fewer American things, because made in America products suddenly got twice as expensive if you earn euros. Wow, I suddenly want inflation really badly. Let's weaken our currency. Well, as you can imagine, a weak currency isn't the greatest thing since sliced bread. I mean, my gut is telling me, geez, having a near worthless currency probably isn't great. And yeah, it isn't if you're in America's situation.
But if unemployment's really low, a country likes to have an expensive currency. That increases people's purchasing power and it keeps prices down.
Heck yeah, purchasing power. Basically, our currency is worth so much more than those cheap imports from a now weak currency to Europe. Well, they're really cheap and I can use my money to do other things. This is the problem the Eurozone's facing with determining currency values, because Germany and France want cheap stuff made in China, while Greece, Italy, and Spain all want more exports. Basically, Germany isn't happy.
Germany's finance minister says the country will stick to its austerity course despite mounting criticism, and others in the Eurozone should keep focused on cutting their budgets, while Chancellor Angela Merkel voiced worries over a possible interest rate cut by the European Central Bank, saying that it could harm the German economy. She said the ECB is obviously in a difficult position. For Germany circumstances, it would actually have to raise rates slightly right now, but for other countries, it would have to do even more to make more liquidity available, and especially for that liquidity to reach corporate financing.
Well, she seems to have taken it in stride. So the European Central Bank had a plan. They were going to buy sovereign government bonds, or basically lend governments money. Great, you're going to buy government bonds. Shouldn't be too complicated. Oh wait, never mind, this is the Eurozone, so everything gets infinitely confusing. When you're trying to increase inflation of a shared currency by buying government bonds, which government do you buy those bonds from? I mean, you got Germany, a country with so little debt, this program actually started running out of bonds to buy. Originally, some suggested it could buy Eurozone bonds in relation to the amount of debt each country had outstanding, which would essentially make this a Greek bailout program, to the point where it's more Greek than going into debt to see my big fat Greek wedding while sipping on a double big gulp of olive oil. This would pose a problem though, because...
When you talk about side effects, what are you most concerned about?
If you buy government bonds at a large scale, what you do is, of course, you lower the incentive for government to do the structural reforms, which we actually do need in Europe and especially in the Eurozone and parts of the Eurozone.
And just that happened, because shortly after the Greek election, Greece tried to play hardball and it got kicked out of the quantitative easing program. I mean, it's not like Greece could use an easing of government debt. Because of this, ironically enough, Germany, the country that least wanted this, is the recipient of the vast majority of the funds. What? Wow, the European Central Bank gave most of the money to the richest country. I'm not surprised, just disappointed. So how the hell did that happen? Well, the way the European Central Bank agreed to distribute the money was it bought government bonds in proportion to each country's share of the ECB's paid in capital. So the countries that put the most money into the central bank quite literally got the most money out. Wow, forget putting money into the economy, fund that bank. Alright, so for the past few years, Germany has been bailed out from being the most successful country in Europe. Alright, so why are we talking about this today? Well, this story came to my attention because this program is ending in a matter of months and the European Central Bank just published a report about what it changed.
First, our anticipated end in asset purchases in December this year is subject to incoming data, confirming the medium-term inflation outlook.
Nothing quite like Working Paper 2970. Really feels special. As you can probably tell from the title page, this was not a fun read, so I'm not going to try and directly quote it. to avoid getting too technical, because what the hell is that? Get it away. We're gonna focus on the broader important parts of this report rather than how the sausage was made. The first graph of note was changing the wealth distribution aspects of these asset purchases, and it's weird. Poor people's wealth grew much faster than anyone else's wealth. Now, some people are attributing that to, if you give a poor person 20 bucks, who knows, maybe you doubled his wealth. Well, it takes a whole lot more to even begin to move that ticker for rich people. But look at this graph. First, of course the rich got a lot more growth from bonds and stocks. But do you want to know how weird this whole thing is? Just listen to the report. For all Euro area countries, this program translates into a decrease in wealth inequality. The result is surprising because asset price increases will tend to benefit the higher part of the net wealth distribution, where home ownership and especially stock ownership are more prevalent. Wow, really showing your hand on that one. Harold, darling, on our quest for personal enrichment, we actually ended up disproportionately helping the poor. Isn't that a marvelous surprise? When they tried quantitative easing in the UK...
We think that Bank of England's monetary policy measures, such as very low interest rates and quantitative easing, proved successful in restoring confidence and supporting economic recovery in the UK. But in our view, an unintended consequence has been to amplify already high wealth disparity between the richest and poorest sections of the society.
I can tell you that, through measuring changes in the Gini coefficient, which measures income distribution, and trust me, it's a whole mathematical thing I know most of you don't want me to get into, we can say that objectively the wealth gap has shrunk due to this program. So how did the ECB stumble its way into helping the poor? The first reason is debt. Poor people in that time had a lot of debt on their houses in Europe, and that's a fun thing about decreasing the value of money. All of a sudden that money you owe, well, it's objectively worth less, and you didn't even have to do anything. Imagine if a few years ago you gave me a loan and said, Stephen, I'll give you $1,000, but in 3 years, you have to give me that autographed Bill Cosby written romantic advice book worth $1,500. It helps you put the sensual back in non-consensual. Well, without doing anything, I would benefit hugely from the fact that by this time, I'd have to give it to you, and that book is now worth less than the paper it's written on. The other big reason this helped poor people is kind of what we talked about earlier. It disproportionately benefited poor countries. Might be the one time it's appropriate to say, "Damn, look at those nice curves!" And this is why you see publications like Reuters reporting that the ECB's bond purchasing may have cut income inequality, but only a bit. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that.